This is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today I have another exciting episode for you. We're here on another field trip to Half Moon Bay Nursery. So I was actually down here, my brother's kids having a birthday party down the street at a little ranch where they have pony rides and train rides and all this kind of stuff. But I thought I'd stop at the nursery to check it out because I always like visiting nurseries to see what kind of things are growing on and how they will allow you to grow more food at home, including the seeds, and to see if there's any unusual plant starts. I did look this place up online and it said they have a massive collection and selection of plants, both non-edible and edibles. But I'm here today to focus on the edibles and I'm gonna share with you what's available here, and maybe this is gonna benefit you if you live in the San Francisco Bay Area. It's probably worth a drive out here. This place is just massive and it's just really cool nonetheless. So let's head inside. In this area, they have such a wide selection of fruit trees. These are basically fruit trees that are coming in the pots. And this is, happens to be apples, though, good old Gravenstein apple. And they have a lot of different varieties of apples, and they got peaches and pears and everything else. And I always encourage you to plant fruit trees if you don't want to tend to a vegetable garden. Fruit trees are a lot easier. That will produce food for you with a lot less effort. So instead of growing a vegetable garden for less maintenance, you could do a fruit tree, or you could do the vines. So vines can be nice to fill in. They could maybe grow as a shrub or a vine and fill in like along a fence. So it's an excellent use to use some, you know, vertical space along a hurricane fence, for example. In this area, they have some blueberries. Over here, they have raspberries, blackberries, boysenberries, even gooseberries and currants. And they have many varieties here. Actually, here's one really cool right here. This is actually the fall gold raspberry. So this raspberry, instead of being red like all the common ones, it's orange. In this area, they have the grape plants, and if you go to a local big box store, they may have one or two varieties of grape plants, and usually they're like, you know, Thompson seedless or some other variety. But I really want to encourage you to grow a diversity in different crops, not just the stuff that's standardly available at big box stores, and to support a local nursery that's probably going to have a wider selection than your local big box store, like they do here. Actually, this is one of my favorite grapes right here. This is the California Concord grape. Really amazing flavor. And over here, even you can grow your own wine grapes. So wine grapes, while you think they are just good for making wine, actually, if you've ever tasted just grapes and wine grapes, they actually have an amazing flavor. They're even better eating than the standard, you know, red and Thompson seedless grapes that you buy in the store that, to me, have no flavor. But wine grapes have an amazing flavor because, after all, they're growing the wine grapes for the flavor of the wine. So those grapes, before they're processed into the wine, also have an amazing flavor and actually are really high in sugar because it's that sugar that converts into the alcohol to make the wine. So they have these standard planters here, and actually these are already pre-planted with strawberries you could just take home and grow. Now, it's actually a fair bit of money to do that. You know, these planters are good for strawberries and maybe some things like herbs, but I wouldn't want to plant any vegetables in here. In addition, they got all the strawberry plants here. And once again, here at the nursery, they got all kinds of different cool strawberries. And instead of just growing your standard big market strawberries that you'd buy at your supermarket, I would highly encourage you to grow something like this. This is the Alpine strawberry, and this Alpine is actually yellow in color. So this strawberry plant makes some really small strawberries or Alpine strawberries, and they have an amazing flavor without that much sugar. Also, because these are yellow, the birds don't know they're ripe and they won't eat them. So they're bird proof as well. Down over in this area, they have some other cool things. And actually what we're looking at here are the roots or the bulbs of the rhubarb. So I like it here that you could actually select individual plants. So if you go to a big box store, once again, you're gonna have to buy a package of these guys, and they're probably gonna be much smaller. These are nice, healthy rhubarb roots to buy. And you know, if selecting a rhubarb root set, you want to just, you know, get a nice big one. So obviously this is the same price for this small one, or you could get this nice large one. And because there's more root mass on this, it's just going to be healthier and grow larger in the long run. So if you can select them out, buy the biggest ones you can pick. Over in this area, they have several varieties of strawberries, including Sequoia, Quinault, and Seascape. I think Seascape is really popular in this area. And once again, this is how you buy these strawberries here. You get to basically pick them out, and you just buy them by the plant. If you're buying them in a big box store, they're usually cut down at this point, not growing yet. And I mean, you'll get them, but this way I like to just buy them and select them individually and get ones with large root balls as possible. Also, you can see also, you know, The smaller the root ball, the smaller the plant, the larger the root ball, the larger the plant, and that's going to mean, in the end, more berries for you. In addition, here at the end, they're selling horseradish roots. So, you know, just a cutting of a horseradish root that's not even whole will basically root and grow into a whole new horseradish plant. So the horseradish, you know, made popular by the horseradish sauce, definitely really good. And you can eat the greens, although I don't recommend it. They can actually have a nice horseradish flavor as well. And finally, they got the asparagus roots here. So asparagus roots, man, they're cheap here. 10 for $7 or 75 cents each. You're just basically going to buy this. And these roots are still alive. And you can see here, it's just putting up a little asparagus shoot right there. So you're going to plant these, and basically asparagus, you want to plant them with a lot of nice, like, composted or rotted leaves down below, and then put them in compost and grow a lot of these guys. And these guys are like a perennial plant, so you want to plant these once, and every year they're going to come back year after year. And you're also going to get, besides the asparagus, you're going to get a nice asparagus ferns that are nice and beautiful too. So I'm glad that they have these guys here just by the each, and you could pick them out. So, you know, it's not too many nurseries that have, you know, rooting roots and tubers like this, that you can just pick out the nice largest ones. And oh, check it out. You know, here's one you could buy for 75 cents. And I mean, it already has a little baby asparagus. So take this home, plant it, and soon enough, you'll have an asparagus plant. That being said, you know, if you are planting these for the first time, you want to let them grow out and not just, you know, cut off all of them at once, because they do need to grow out and get mature. And, you know, asparagus plants will take maybe 2-3 years to ramp up production. In the first year, really, they're not going to produce too much for you, so don't be alarmed. If you are growing vertically, I definitely recommend proper staking to stake things up and grow vertically. They have a set collection of stakes here, redwood stakes, but I like the bamboo stakes. They're a lot more economical. Oh, and this will lead us into the ceramic pot area. So they have a lot of different varieties of ceramic pots, but my favorite ones that they're selling here are these guys right here. This is kind of like the garden stick, but this is like the industrial garden stick, and I wish this was a lot taller. This is basically a clay pot with holes in it so that you can grow things out of it. And actually, this diameter, man, it's about maybe a foot in diameter. This is definitely a nice piece of ceramic. For those of you that are worried about PVC leaching, you know, you could now buy one in ceramic, or if you're a person that does ceramics, hey, just make your own. This thing is probably definitely a pretty penny. I could see stacking these up one on top of the other and just having like literally a tower of plants. And this is, it says frost resistant, and this is from Terracino. The price on these guys, I think, are about $62, but these guys are gonna last a long time, and I definitely like it better than the PVC, but maybe I wish they had been a little bit smaller diameter. But nonetheless, this is cool. I haven't seen anything like this before. Next, let's head over into some of the greenhouses and take a look at some flowers that are edible, but not necessarily sold as vegetables. On either side of me, you can see we have all edible flowers, but what is edible to me is ornamental to many people. Over on this side, we got violas, and then closely related, we have the pansies on the other side. These are nice 4-inch pots, and you can eat these flowers. They're absolutely colorful. They have a great flavor. And what many people don't know is that you can also eat the greens. The greens you could add to salad, and they're also edible. And have a flavor just a little bit stronger than the pansy, which in my opinion is really mild. So besides attracting beneficial insects to your garden, this is a nice functional plant. And I would encourage everybody to have some edible flowers in their garden to make it look pretty, but also be functional. And you could eat them for their antioxidant content as well. So now we're in the vegetable section, and this is where they have the vegetables and also the herbs. And once again, a local nursery like this is going to have a much wider selection than a big box store. And you can see here, this is just some of the herbs. They got Florence fennel, chervil, Italian oregano, spearmint, peppermint, chocolate mint, epizote. This is a fun one to grow. So this one, I don't know, it seems to me that they're selling it a little bit early because it doesn't like to get too cold. But here in Half Moon Bay, the weather's more temperate, so it actually doesn't freeze quite as often. But let's see here, rosemary, all kinds of different herbs here. It smells amazing. Here are just some of the vegetables available right now at this point. They have all the winter and spring vegetables ready to plant, including the kales and the brassicas and lettuces, and I saw some peas and spinach. But what I would recommend is that when you guys are going to go buy six packs, don't buy your arugula in a six pack. Arugula is fairly easy to grow from seed, and besides growing really fast, it can also bolt in the six pack. So here's one that's nice and young, which I would buy if I was going to buy arugula, but I have arugula growing as a weed at my place now. What happens is this right here. You can see here's some arugula that's now getting tall, leggy, and actually bolting. So if you went and bought this arugula plant, it would not really last long and not really give you that much food. So it'd be much better to buy them when they're younger. But you don't want to buy them when they're too young, because then they won't be growing and established as much. So you want to get a nice middle-aged plant. Nonetheless, a lot of these plants here look like they're in really good shape and nice, from cauliflower to chard, celery, lettuce. They have just such a wide selection here that you're not going to find, once again, at a local big box store. So come visit Half Moon Bay Nursery or another local nursery to you that's going to carry probably a wider selection of plants, so that you can grow a wide variety of foods instead of just what your local big box store is offering. So now we're in a section here at the Half Moon Bay Nursery of all the orchids, and they're absolutely beautiful, but they're not edible. So next, let's go to another section that has some more edibles, actually, namely seeds. And they actually have a wide selection of seeds you can purchase here, so that you can grow a wide variety of crops at your home. So this is the moment I've been waiting for to share with you guys the seeds that they have available here. They have a big wide selection, more so than many nurseries that I've visited. They have many different seed sellers and are selling different brands of seeds, and each one of those brands have many different varieties. So let's go take a look at some of them next. So here they have these seeds of change, and these are the same seeds of change that you saw in a previous episode that they're now selling at the Home Depot. Some of these guys actually look to be the same varieties. Here's some more varieties of seeds of change that are not available at the Home Depot. Seeds of change has many different varieties, so that's really cool. But in addition to the seeds of change, they got one of my favorite brands or seed sellers. This is Seed Savers Exchange. So Seed Savers Exchange, they will come out with some, you know, more unique and rare varieties of vegetables. One of my favorite Seed Savers Exchange seeds are right here. This is actually called the Golden Sweet Pea. And these are collected from a market in India. Tall 6-foot plants with beautiful bicolored purple flowers and bright yellow pink pods. Best eaten when small, excellent for stir fries. So I grew these last year and they were amazing color. Although the taste, they probably could have been sweeter, but definitely cool nonetheless. I'm probably gonna grow some of these this year. Next in this area, they have Thompson Morgan seeds. So these are seeds from the UK, and these are different varieties than we would normally get here in the United States. So I definitely think it's really cool. They have all different kinds of things. Here's a cut and come again cilantro, organic carrot, yellow stone carrots. They got herbs and all different kinds of varieties, once again, that may be more resistant. Here's one right here, impressive mildew resistance for this organic spinach Palco F1 hybrid. Next, let's take a look right over here. More seeds, and these are some local seeds. This is from a company that's locally, Kitazawa Seed. They focus on Asian vegetables. So these are some Asian vegetables. They got some Thai red basil, mini sweet carrots. Let's see here, Chinese leeks. Oh, here's one I like a lot, the chrysanthemum greens. They got the garden cress. Let's see, I'll pick out one more cool. Oh, manoa lettuce. I love to eat manoa lettuce when I'm in Hawaii. Probably my favorite Kitazawa seed is right here. I've never seen a mixture like this before. This is actually called the edible flower mixture, and it says it has borage, cilantro, nasturtium, calendula, cornflower, dianthus, wee willie, chives, mint, pansy, lavender hyssop, and English daisy. Man, so that's really cool, this edible flower mixture by Kitazawa. So yeah, I would encourage you to grow some edible flowers. Next over in this area, more Thompson Morgan seeds from the UK. This one's called Sugar Snacks 54 F1 Hybrid, and it's labeled the sweetest carrot. Oh, and here's some carrots if you want to grow them in containers. These are Parmex containers. They look like little round carrots. Oh, and of course, you want to eat your foods of color, and here's one, purple dragon carrots. Oh, and check this out. This is really cool. Free with any two packs of Thompson Morgan seeds. Looks like you got some mignonette strawberry seeds. Definitely cool. Over on this side, more seeds. This is Renee's garden seeds. Once again, you know, just wide variety of different seeds that you can choose to grow at home. And man, there's even more down, Italian seeds from Franchi. So let's check those out. Here are some seeds from Italy, and these Italian seeds, definitely really cool. I like these. They're nice large packets, and each packet contains a lot of seeds. Also, these are, I think, how companies should pack their seeds. It's kind of like a paper, but it's coated paper, so it's not gonna allow the moisture in, you know, like many of the paper packets from companies here in the States. So these seeds are definitely better for storing for longer periods of time. And these are some, looks like some radishes. Now, while the front of the package is mostly in Italian, there is some English translation on the back. It says, early bright red uniform round bulbs with good resistance to going woody. And this is radish burro gigante. One of the things that I've noticed is that the Italians and the seeds from Franchi seem to really focus on some of the leafy greens and some of the more unique leafy greens that we don't literally eat here, because maybe that's in the heritage. So I'd encourage you to grow more leafy greens, or just grow more greens and eat them too, because once again, they're one of the most nutrient-dense foods on the planet. Even the bitter greens can definitely be added to green smoothies and juices just a little bit to basically give your juice that kick you've been looking for. Some of their Franchi seeds I like a lot are, number one, down here they have seeds for sprouting. So they have sprouting seeds here on the bottom, all different seeds for sprouting. And then more importantly, they got some really cool squashes. So, you know, you might be familiar with just the standard squashes like zucchini squash, yellow crookneck, and sunburst, and things like that. But they got these cool ones here. This is like a serpent squash, trombona squash with all different kind of shapes, sizes, and colors. Custard white squash. But once again, a place like this in a local nursery may contain, or, so once again, a place like this sells a wide variety of seeds from Italy, from a local Bay Area company, from all over, so that you can grow more varieties and foods literally from around the world in your front yard or backyard garden. So here's another area that I'm excited about. This is the citrus section. And this citrus section, it's covered because they don't want their citrus trees getting too cold. And they have a wide variety, so let's go ahead and highlight just a few of them I like a lot. Upon entering the citrus section, you're gonna notice one of my favorite trees that I'm growing. This is the pineapple guava tree right here. And you can see right here, it's currently flowering. And the pineapple guava grows really well here in the Bay Area climate and is a steady producer year after year. I got unnamed varieties, but they're selling the named variety Coolidge here. And it says, flowers 1 inch long, showy and edible, elongated fruit, 4 inches long, mild flavor, dependable and heavy bear, self-fertile tree, upright and vigorous. So sometimes pineapple guavas can grow as a big bush, sometimes they can grow as a tree, but it also depends on how you choose to train them. Next, oh man, here's a crazy citrus tree right here. This is called the Flying Dragon. This is a bitter orange. Yellow fruit is very tart. And check it out, this thing is so thorny. That's insane. Sour orange, Seville sour orange, Kara Kara navel, Robinson navel, yuzu, that's a citron, Washington navel, Moro blood. So these blood oranges, if you've never seen them before, there's no fruit on the tree, but here it is. The Moro blood is a unique kind of purplish color on the inside, which will basically give you more purple antioxidants. And actually, they have a nice, unique flavor. Trevita orange, Valencia, Satsuma mandarins, Dancy's, lime quads, different kinds of lime quads. Oh, and here's one. This one's like an up-and-comer. Most people don't know about this one, and it's right here. This one's actually called the Australian finger lime. So this is a crop that I just learned about fairly recently. Oh man, and they're fairly inexpensive. It's $32.50. These finger limes fruits produce small little limes that actually you break open and you basically squeeze out all the little areoles, and they're like, they're tart, and I really haven't had a fully ripe one yet, so one day I hope to get them. But man, they're definitely a curiosity, and like, they're really being popular now with like frou-frou chefs. Kaffir limes, oh, Kaffir limes, if you're going to get one lime tree, get the kaffir lime. Not only does it produce the limes, but the leaves are also used in ethnic cooking. Oh, here's one of my favorites. I love limes, but you know, you might think limes are always kind of have like a lime taste, but this is actually a Palestine sweet lime. The sweet limes, they actually taste really neutral. They really are just have a nice citrus flavor without having the acid, and are mildly sweet, not necessarily sweet as like orange, maybe an unripe orange, but they're definitely good, and they are hard to find if you're just trying to buy sweet limes, but they're, you know, you could grow one and have your own sweet limes. But here's a plant, you know, that would be a good deal to buy because it's already loaded up with fruit. This guy is actually $110, so definitely is going to cost you a bit, but man, look, it's just already got the improved Meyer lemons. So the Meyer lemons are a sweeter kind of lemon that you may not have seen. They're fairly popular in this area, but many people have no clue about the Meyer lemon. Much like there's different varieties of apples, you know, Fuji apples, Red Delicious, Granny Smith, there's other varieties of lemons as well. All lemons aren't the same. You know, lemons you think of as kind of like, you know, lemony, a little bit bitter, sour, not good. But man, when these guys get ripe, and you can see here, this is the coloring on how a Meyer lemon should be when it's ripe. Gets like a nice, dark, rich, yellow, almost orange color. And they get a little bit soft. Oh man, they're just, they have a hint of the lemon, but also, you know, a faint sweetness as well. They're absolutely my favorite, and you can eat the skin and all on the Meyer lemons. They just have like a wide variety. This is probably one of the largest varieties of citrus I've seen anywhere. Here's another cool one, the variegated pink lemon. So once again, just another variety of lemon that you can buy. You know, the leaves are variegated, and also the fruits are variegated too. But, and here's all the different grapefruits. Over at the end here, they have some avocado plants. So they got some lamb Haas avocados and some regular Haas avocados. But in general, I wouldn't necessarily recommend buying a Haas avocado unless maybe you live here in Half Moon Bay where it doesn't freeze. These guys are fairly, you know, sensitive to frost, and you may want to look for other more frost-tolerant varieties than just the standard lamb Haas, which actually, based on my research, is not too frost tolerant. So here's another cool plant I love a lot. This is once again an evergreen, keeps its leaves all year long. And this guy, my tree is super huge and finally fruited for the first year in about 6 years, but I did plant it from seed. So mine's an unnamed variety, but when buying fruit trees at a local nursery, a good nursery, you're gonna be able to buy named varieties of fruit. So what is named variety? Well, that's right here. We can look on the little tag. This is called the loquat tree, and this is the gold nugget loquat. So the loquat, the gold nugget, I think, produces a nice large loquat, and you know, it's probably gonna be sweeter and bred for the size rather than just seeds you throw in the ground and you kind of get what you get. So very important to select the variety that's gonna do the best for you, taste the best for you, and grow the best for you, because especially if you have a small residential space, you don't wanna be wasting space on trees that aren't gonna be top of the top. At the Half Moon Bay Nursery, they also sell Annie's annuals. Now, Annie annuals have lots of plants and they're not all edible, but there are a select few. And just in the past episode, you saw me with the Cretan rock lettuce. And actually, I bought that at Annie's and wasn't able to make a video there for you guys because that place is amazing. But I'm happy to say here at the Half Moon Bay Nursery, they're selling that right here, the Cretan rock lettuce. And I'm so amazed, and I'm actually gonna buy probably like a flat of these guys to plant out. This is a perennial, and it's also edible, and it also has an amazing flavor, a little bit sweet, and actually they're fairly drought tolerant as well. So I'm super glad the Half Moon Bay Nursery is here, and they sell a wide selection of non-edibles, but also edibles as well. Here's another cool plant that I've actually rarely seen nurseries carry. This nursery has actually some fairly large ones. This one's actually called the curry leaf plant. This is a native to India, creamy white flowers in the summer. The leaves are used to make curries and other spicy dishes, needs frost protection. So we're actually right here on the entrance to their greenhouse here. And this plant doesn't look too happy, but this one right here, this thing is actually nice and tall and huge, and it's actually doing fairly well. If you do want to grow a curry plant, you would probably definitely need to put it in a greenhouse year round for it to do well in your area. I tried to grow this outside, didn't make it. I'm now growing a much smaller one in a greenhouse, and it appears to be doing find this winter. So I just picked up 6 Cretan rock lettuces, all the ones that they had that looked healthy to me, and I'm gonna plant these and grow them at home and grow more of them. And I've really enjoyed my visit here to Half Moon Bay Nursery, and I would encourage you, if you guys live in the area, to come out, check it out. They have a wide selection of plants, seeds, starch, both edibles and non-edibles, and especially the Cretan rock lettuce. So I did warn them that they may be getting a few calls in the near future for this stuff, but I don't know. We'll see how it goes. Anyways, I gotta head out. I got a whole bunch of other stuff to do today, but hopefully you've enjoyed this episode. Once again, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and keep on growing.